Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
I'm hearing echo. Okay, so thanks to this pandemic situation, which presented us ways to connect each other, providing us these digital platforms. Of course, these were previously also there, but we hardly explored it because physical environment was always available. So we can consider this as a blessing in disguise. This PICA Thesis Forum is an initiative we have started from this year. So basically, it serves various purposes. First of all, and the most important is the current batches learn, get benefited and by the peers' work and get motivated and encouraged to excel in their research or thesis using the experience and difficulties that their seniors have come across. Another thing is it's a great platform to appreciate our alumni students who really performed well in their thesis by putting their heart and soul. They worked relentlessly towards success. So it's a kind of an opportunity for us to appreciate their work, their efforts and success. PICA Thesis Forum will allow us to do that. Another thing is it will also act as a splendid way to connect with our previous batches as we assume that the classmates of the invited students also looking for this opportunity to attend these sessions and appreciate their classmates. Of course, we can see many of them are attending these sessions. So it's a great thing for us to see you all here. It's a proud feeling basically for all of us to that you have proved yourself with the excellent work, and we, the teachers, are in a way responsible to shape you through the 5 years that you were in PICA. So we consider your success as our success also. On behalf of our faculty and students, I welcome Anushka and Kunal in PICA Thesis Forum 2020. This is an inaugural session to present their thesis and share their work, views and experiences. Kavita, I think, please take over.
Tejashri, would you like to start moderating this session?
Yes. Thank you, Kavita. Thank you, Sudhna, ma'am. Welcome one and all. As our ma'am have already specified that this is the initiative, yet another initiative by MES Pillai College of Architecture and a very creative platform for showcasing the great works of our alumni. I welcome Kunal Jain and Anushka Shahadatpuri, our today's presenters. And it was a
mummy ko bol mam.
And it was really a great pleasure to always been a part of their thesis journey and have witnessed and have also witnessed their success and failures both during the journey. So Anushka sets an example of challenge taker, the one who does not really give up at all. And Kunal is somebody who have always been consistent, who have always been a hard worker. So we are definitely going to have a wonderful session today, and we are definitely going to have some very good takeaway for both the students and the other alumni who have joined us today. Thank you, everyone. We, without wasting that any more time, we should start the session. Anushka, I invite you to please start your presentation.
Yeah. Thank you, Tejashri ma'am, for those kind words. I would, before starting with my thesis, I would officially like to thank a lot of people who've contributed in this thesis like their own. This thesis wouldn't have been possible without their hard work and dedication along with me, right from my mentor, Miss Madhavi Patel. Then I would like to thank I would like to thank Smita Dalvi ma'am for her constant motivation, Sangamitra ma'am for always believing in me, and Venki sir and Tejashri ma'am for always being there like the strong pillars. And apart from that, Imran, Rozan, Shreya, Nidhi, there are so many. I can't remember all of them, but yeah, like, thank you all of them who've constantly been there with me throughout the whole journey of 1 year, for constantly being there and supporting in whatever you've done. So it's not my thesis alone, it's our thesis that I'll be presenting today. So I'll just start now. I'm not able to share my screen. Ma'am, can you allow me to share my screen?
Kiran, is it possible at your end?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, please.
Yeah, go ahead, Anushka.
Yes, we can see your screen, Anushka.
So the dissertation cogitates over the scale and emergent patterns of contemporary urbanization that challenge the notion of permanence as the condition for cities. The thesis tries to study the rubrics like informality, temporality, reversibility, which become counterproductive as these implicitly aspire new protocols and formulations in imagining permanence. In this case, the thesis tries to understand if permanence as a sole instrument in urban realities, in urban imaginaries, really matter. So the scale and the pace of contemporary urbanization challenges these notions of permanence as a basic condition of cities. As we know, the tier one cities, for instance, like Mumbai, have a urban area with a population of 22.7 million, which is forecasted to stretch to an even more ungovernable 25 million before they close to the next decade. In such scenarios of constant flux, how can we analyze cities that accommodate these constant flux? As in contemporary urbanism, these cities are complex overlays of buildings and activities governed by the static and the kinetic city together, which this thesis identifies as a form.
Anushka, do you want to display anything?
Yeah, display, yes. Is any display missing at your end, Anushka?
I am presenting the presentation.
No, we can see only the VLC file, which is stopped. Can you show the presentation? You may have to go to some other file.
Yeah.
Would you like to restart?
Yeah, sorry. So the dissertation cogitates over the scale and emergent patterns of contemporary urbanization that challenges the notion of permanence as a default condition for cities. This thesis tries to study the rubrics like informality, temporality, and reversibility. flexibility, which become counterproductive as they implicitly aspire new protocols and formulations in imagining permanence. In this case, the thesis tries to understand if permanence as a sole instrument in urban imaginaries really matter. The scale and pace of contemporary urbanism challenges the notion of permanence as a default condition of cities, as the tier one cities, for instance, Mumbai, has an urban area with a population of 22.7 million, which is forecasted to stretch to an even more ungovernable 25 million before the close to the next decade. In such scenarios of constant flux, how can we analyze cities that accommodate these constant flux? As in the contemporary urbanism, these cities are complex overlays of buildings, activities, which are governed by the static city and the kinetic city, which the thesis identifies as the formal and the informal city that are changing over time. So why just focus on permanence? This thesis further tries to argue a more elastic expression, which is determined by the logic of the city itself. The logic of the city thus is governed both by the static and the kinetic city together, where the static city is predominantly this object-centric city, which is governed by the hard infrastructure, and the kinetic city, like for instance, a simple street, a street that we see in a market, which is constantly getting consumed, reused, recycled, and reinterpreted in the same day itself, wherein there are these different stages of incrementality that, like, for instance, if you look at a street hawker, when he's a new hawker setting up his own shop at a pavement, he starts with a small, a mat on the footpath. And as and when he starts earning more and more money, he starts improving his infrastructure. He adds in two more sacks. And then the third scenario wherein he starts to have even a more hard infrastructure wherein he starts to develop these sort of semi-permanent structures which start to develop on top of it. And the fourth stage wherein he knows that this is the area from where he's now earning a good hafta and wants to continue in that same place is when he starts having starts going towards a more sort of a permanent structure. So we see as the permanence sort of increases, the elasticity decreases. So it's always that the static and the kinetic city sort of coexist together, wherein if we look at the nature, it's always in dichotomy, but they sort of coexist for the city to function together. So in order to sort of understand the city and the repercussions of permanence, it is important to understand how and where the permanence was failing in the city. The thesis tried to study the influx in MMR and identify areas which are in constant flux. The suburb of Thane in the last decade came out to be the largest district in Mumbai. In comparison to the inner city areas and the outer Mumbai, we see that Thane as a district, whereas these two areas of inner city and outer city of Mumbai were experiencing a stagnant growth, we see that the suburb of Thane has been in the peak of 2001-2011 census, capturing 74% of the larger MMR growth. On looking at the city of Thane, this thesis further identifies these six locations in the city depending on the scale and taxonomy of the ephemera. For instance, the central Maidan court near the court Naka, we observe that there is a daily ephemera wherein people come to play in the Maidan, and it's from morning to evening. It's been used by the kids and to play, and in occasions of prominent festivals, it's been used by these prominent political parties to set up their own temporary installations and carry out their functions on the ground itself. So we see a daily ephemera that's occurring and also a seasonal ephemera that's occurring depending on the nature of the use of the space. Then the Upwan Lake, which observes, in contrary to a daily ephemera, it observes a seasonal ephemera, wherein during the Upwan Art Festival, which occurs once in a year, the whole space is sort of transformed to suit the needs of the festival itself. And on studying these six locations, the thesis finally narrowed down to this one location, which is Jamli Naka itself, near the Thane railway station, which observes a combination of seasonal ephemera, daily ephemera. Depending, for instance, in morning, it functions as a busy vegetable market, which the following slides. Yeah, so if we look at this particular stretch, which the thesis identifies, I've tried to bifurcate them in different zones. And what we observe is that depending on the various zones observe different uses, the stretch is being used plays a role in the times of Navratri celebration. It's been converted into this festive stretch wherein the vehicular access is completely cut off and the stretch is completely used by vendors to celebrate Navratri for 9 days. For instance, the market here, which is a daily ephemera, is being used as a wholesale market throughout the morning and is converted into it works as a vegetable market in the morning and is converted into a wholesale market wherein many things like garments, utensils, many things are being sold during the evening. And if you observe the lake front here, the lake edge is also being, response to a particular time in space. How do we then sort of imagine reversibility and openness in terms of architecture of the space? And that being said, the area of study also has a deep relationship that it extends to the inner city areas. So to which the thesis responds is that there is an area of study which is the place of change, and its response in terms of the agents of change who are not only causing the change in itself, but are also interacting, causing change, which are agents of change in terms of the inner city areas. For example, the vegetable wholesale market in the inner city area, the vegetables are being purchased by these small vendors from the main market, Manisha Market, or located in Jamli Naka, which is then being supplied throughout the inner city area. So these are the different routes, and these are the different relationships which and these are basically mobile agents, which are not static in place, but are bringing around change in different parts of the society, in different parts of the city. So if we are to see the change in place itself, like this is the whole area of Jamli Naka, and this is where the entire site in space is located, which currently is here is a barren ground, and this is the street which functions as a heavy vegetable market street between morning 6 a.m. to 9 or 10 a.m. And this is the route which directly takes you to the station. And we see all these mobile vendors which occupy this street, which then transforms into this this place wherein there are again vendors but selling out different things. And the whole purpose of the street is to respond to these different occupations and different things in time. And again at night, we see that these formal shops which have been closed down, and the place of the foot of the shop is being used by these mobile vendors to sell different things which they want to sell. And even these mobile eatery shops which sort of come out in front of these formal shops. So there is this always this sense of a barter that's happening, and there's always the sense of coexistence that's happening. So how do we then facilitate these active fluxes in, you know, the notion of architecture? How do we sort of, how does the time factor in design? And can we think of time as a factor in design? And can we not design for absolute and think of transition as the city already is functioning in terms of, because the city actually is so in terms of, you know, it's so porous, it allows you to sort of coexist, it allows you to sort of, you know, be there in space and, you know, it allows you to do various things at one time. So how can, you know, then the kinetic landscape overlay on the static landscape? So in terms of what then I did was, the second part of it was to sort of, after the research part, was to then look at the whole precinct and start identifying these small issues which had some potential to translate into an architectural intervention. And what I did was to sort of try to look at the various issues in terms of at a precinct level and document them. So what we generally see is that the lake edge here, we see that it has this direct connection with the barren land here, the barren ground here, which remains barren throughout the year, but essentially is used only during Navratri or some Ganesh festival. And also during the time when I was doing my thesis is the time wherein we observed the unfortunate event of Pulwama attack. And this whole stretch was being used as a candle march. So this the thing that already exists on site was the kind of image that it is created for the people. Why was this site chosen by the people to come here and do a candle march? Why not somewhere else? Because this area itself had that image which existed for the people, because of the kind of interdisciplinary functions that already sort of this place accommodates in. So there were these different connections which were, you know, which did not exist in terms of problems. Then how could we think of this ground to sort of, you know, how can it factor in time? How can it, because it's left barren throughout the year. So how can it sort of, you know, become the get into the fabric of the city itself? And how can this vegetable market then respond to this different, you know, different time, like it changes with time. So how can the architecture of the market itself respond to that change in time? So these were the different, and this continuous stretch here again is open garden, which essentially currently is open to, like, there is illegal construction happening because of the dense foliage that you see around it. It's exposed to vandalism. There are a lot of people who come and drink here, and, you know, there's a lot of shady things that are happening inside this garden here. And even when the entire space around it is so vibrant, it's still because of this dense foliage, this place still becomes a shady space wherein people can, you know, sort of do whatever they want. So the idea of the thesis was then to sort of look at these different spatial configurations in terms of the node, the edge of the lake itself, and the street itself, and the place which was the site as a whole, like this whole stretch which was the site. I'm sorry, I had to crop it out because the details weren't visible, so I had to crop the map in two for them to be visible on the screen. So yeah, so then what I did was on the basis of the issues findings, what I did was I tried to look out for different programs that can function into that space, same space, depending on the activities that were occurring in space. So as even the video showed that how the street itself was changing with time, but there was absence of architecture in the whole space. In terms of architecture, I mean, there was no infrastructure in that space. So how can the infrastructure come in and then respond to those different, you know, different activities in space? So for this, this was the structure map, which essentially provided me different sorts of propositions which could factor in space. So like the market space itself, how could it be modified for wholesale vendors and retail vendors to sort of come in, and how can it function as a wholesale market in the morning, and how can it function as the retail market in evening? And then like I said that this space was being used as a space for protest, as a space for imagining the image of the city. So how can the city offer, you know, but because of this dense foliage and because of vandalism, how can this area be a safe environment? How can it sort of be a permeable neighborhood? How can it, you know, open to, how can it become a public corridor wherein the current activities can be assembled in itself and can be, can be used in, different functions can be used in response to the time that it occurs. So what I did was, depending on the kind of activities that were occurring on site, I sort of developed a program. Like I categorized different taxonomies depending on the workspace plugin, depending on the cultural plugin, depending on the social plugin, and depending on the utilities, because I observed that there were no public toilets, there was no space for drinking, there were no crèches. Like, those were the responses which I was getting from the site itself, and on depending on that, I sort of developed an area of intervention, because I did not want to locate the entire building in one space and locate it in the space where it was actually occurring. Like, for instance, the workspace plugin, the market itself was occurring in the space itself, but the wholesale market was occurring in street. So depending on that, the areas of intervention were determined, and the kind of spatial requirement, the spatial requirement was derived from there. Like, the market would require a semi-open or an enclosed space. And the in terms of the cultural plugins which were happening in terms of different festivals like the Navratri, Ganpati festivals, they might not require a enclosed space. They might work in a semi-open or an open space. Similarly, in terms of the social plugin like the protests, the community outreach spaces can also function in open spaces. But the utilities, in terms of utilities, they had to be, you know, in enclosed spaces. So depending on that, even the scale of ephemera was determined, because if it's occurring on a daily basis, I had to locate it in a particular space. If it was occurring on a weekly and a monthly basis, it meant that I could accommodate two functions together, because one was occurring on a weekly basis and one was occurring on a yearly or a monthly basis. So I didn't have to provide a dedicated space for them to function. And So what essentially, again, this whole plan is broken into parts for because it should be visible on screen. So in terms of this is the vegetable market here, and when like I said, there doesn't exist a direct connection between the lake edge and the whole intervention itself. So it started even developing connections with the existing context itself, and not imagining the whole space in isolation. So what happens is that one enters through the space from the lake, through the space here, and goes inside these open spaces, which can then be transformed into spaces for exhibition. And here is a space for hawkers on both sides, wherein a person can walk through. Or even like the one side is here is being occupied, being dedicated for a space for hawkers, wherein on this side is a place to sit, and a person can walk through inside and here on the between every 10 to 15 meters I had provided to public toilets because it would be easy for a person to just access. If they wanted to use the public toilet, they could just access the public toilet. Here is a public toilet and they can just come out, after which they enter these areas of social plug-in and cultural plug-in, which had the social plug-in wherein which would conduct community outreach programs, workshops for the people even working or for the daily migrants who are working in the market itself, who are not skill based. And then here is a space for a place to exhibit. And we come down to a space here, which is a space for protest, because predominantly I wanted to respond to all these spaces in real time and in real location where it was happening. And these are the details of each of the plugin. Like this one is, I'll be explaining each intervention in brief. So here, for instance, is the place to rest and the place manifesto. Like these people working in the market would function, like the wholesale market would function only in the morning, and after which they would go and rest and stuff like that and sleep. So it made sense to provide spaces for them, but also keeping in mind that the space should not be used only for that space itself. So if you see, like the whole space is being designed in terms of having open spaces, enclosed spaces, and closed spaces together, wherein this courtyard can be used by a particular group, which is by an NGO who's organizing a particular skill-based program. And these two rooms simultaneously could be used by other people to sort of use for their workshops, or their space in as and when they wanted. Similarly, it could be used for a place to rest. So what was happening was that the whole idea was designing for this was to keep in mind that the infrastructure has to be light and non-rigid and has to be open and multi-purpose. So even the architecture itself of in terms of the walls did not exist. Like I did not design hard infrastructure in terms of walls. The walls were movable and could be in the stage one, it could be introduced as a basic grid, and after which these movable walls could allow them to sort of, you know, convert them into these partition walls and can be used in terms of different uses. And which also had a climatic response is that since it was, it had open spaces on both sides and no wall and openness could allow for cross ventilation. So if you look at different options in terms of space on a regular morning, it could be an early morning to mid-afternoon hours. It could be established as a cultural or social activity that could work in combination to suit according to the individual activity, ranging from personal, social, or at a community communal scale. And in case of a seasonal or a monthly ephemeral, it could be used for a welfare program or a community outreach program. And in terms of, so the whole idea was to have one space and that could respond to various needs in time. Similarly, this is like the facade of the building, which could be sort of like these movable walls could be used like as panels. They could be used to, symbolize a prominent message that was happening. So like I said, in terms like during voting, this space has been converted into a vote hub wherein there are these voting booths wherein people come and vote. So how can, we develop also a strong link between the people and the city, and how can we sort of create awareness through the architecture itself? So the panels of the wall can be then converted into displaying important messages that are sort of occurring inside the space itself. And the edge, like I said, was being converted into a hawker street, can be converted in like there's a small parapet on which hawkers can sort of sit and sell whatever they are selling, and that can be then be used for sitting and can be used for different programs in time. Similarly, as a space to offer wherein these workshop areas which are happening on the top and lower portion of, because it's a still, can be used as different functions throughout the day. And so this is what the current existing infrastructure looks like, which is like just left barren. Half of this, things are broken, vandalized. Here we see school kids bunking, callers sitting here drinking. So how can we sort of imagine, these spaces wherein we can reclaim these spaces and respond to the function that's happening around the city and, interact? How can then the space itself interact with the people? So in terms of the furniture, it's like even the structural members of the YE were designed in terms like using recyclable and reused materials, because like if I'm speaking about if I'm talking about reversibility, temporality, then obviously the material also has to respond to that. This is one of the roof frames which had recyclable bicycle wheels, which could be then movable wheels, which could be then extended to project a screen. So here we see like during a workshop how the screen itself can become a bifurcation and allow for flexibility to sort of happen. And even in terms of the whole landscape of the city, the program itself was very open in terms of, the place to learn, the place to create, the cultural plugin, and the place to repose. So each of it had, and it was an open program which could not, which predominantly wouldn't have to be used as a depending on the need. So the infrastructure sort of the light infrastructure existed, but the functions predominantly inside each of the unit would be then like, for instance, this particular section is here wherein the kids can play, and here is a small amphitheater wherein people can also meet, jamming and stuff like that. And here is a small open library wherein people can come sit and have a small cultural meeting. And then followed by that is a small workshop wherein a place to create and stuff like that. So essentially, the idea was that to sort of keep the city as open as possible and not have rigid infrastructure in place and allow for the edges and the space to sort of work on its own. And in terms of the whole image of the precinct after in place, is if we'd observe was that the ground would then open up to, this playground would then open up to various events that are happening in space, I'm not able to remember the word, but sorry. But yeah, wherein, this whole WhatsApp meet and greet, wherein people can come organize events on WhatsApp, and they have a place in a space wherein they can come meet, organize events. And then here is a vegetable market that is in function. And again, the whole space, which I just walked through. And here are the small illustrations, which sort of depict the city in action. So the whole idea was not to just limit it to that space itself, but also imagine things at a neighborhood level. How would that function? Like if I'm thinking about ephemerality, so how would, open spaces which are left barren, or how would hard edges, or how would playgrounds which are being used only for one space then be reclaimed? And then, how would they function as a space, an open space for all and accessible to all? So, And like I said, the space itself did not have the area of influence was like I mentioned in the beginning that the site also had its like the extended city, right? So it did not just interact with the place itself, but also the agents of change, like the vegetable vendors, during Melas and during Navratri, wherein these various communities, like the one who walk on the rope, or so they would sort of travel from one part of the city to other, like, you know, the major nodes like Majiwada, like Teenhat Naka, then like different Naupara, and in different parts of the city. So the thesis also tried to sort of imagine how would that extended city, how would this mobile infrastructure also sort of work in place. So depending on that I identified these three taxonomies. One was celebration, like I mentioned, these mobile like the people who walk on the road, this mobile entertainment sort of communities who sort of earn on the basis of earn their living on the basis of on these melas and stuff like that. So I try to study the material configurations which they use. Like they travel with a bicycle in hand, and they sell different balloons and stuff like that. So what was the nature of transition, and what were the different domains in which they sort of were functioning, like Majiwada, in different domains of the city? And the other one was the transaction. By transaction, I mean the mobile vegetable vendors who purchased the vegetables from the wholesale market there and went and supplied like on carts or on bicycles in the inner city, in the extended city. And depending on that, these agents of change, I try to identify movable and adjustable infrastructure that can be used by the, which could be clubbed by, like the TMC could sort of take up these mobile vendors. And because the problem is that they are not, like these are informal vendors. These are not, they're not legalized by the TMC itself. Like these vendors keep moving from one place to another because often they are being troubled by the police for hafta and stuff like that. So the idea here was to imagine them as social engines wherein they could be licensed by the TMC. The vans could be licensed by the TMC. In return of that, they could, the facade of these vans could be used to sort of have social messages, like the TMC wants to carry out some program that can be advertised through these social vans, and in return of which these vans and these four typologies can be given to them in response to that they can be legalized and licensed to carry out these activities. So one was the Bhojan Kendra, the other one was the Kachra Prabhanda, the third one was the Haspashilta Vahan and the Manoranjan Vahan, depending on the kind of different activities that I observed on site. And thank you.
Thank you, Anushka, for the wonderful presentation. And we already know that this thesis was also selected as one of the NIASA thesis from our college and was sent to it. And after that, you went on presenting the same to the various different platforms. And I know it must have added to your entire experience and to your journey also. So we will now move on to question answer session. Kiran, can you help me if there are any questions already typed on the chat box?
No, ma'am. Right now, I cannot see any questions on the chat box. We can go ahead with the presentation.
Yes.
Okay. If anyone has any questions, please put your questions on the chat box so that we can go ahead with the Q&A session after the
after Kunal's presentation.
After Kunal's. Kunal, go ahead and start presenting.
Yes. Yeah.
Ma'am, is my screen visible?
Yes, it is visible.
So the topic which I had selected, first of all, I would like to thank my mentor, Tejashri ma'am, Meenal sir, and Chetan Shiva Prasad and Sarat sir, who had helped me throughout the process, right from research to the design process, and to my juniors and my classmates from various years who has helped me in my model making, renderings and everything. So seeing after that, I would like to introduce my topic. The topic which I had selected is Hampi Heritage Interpretation and Convention Center. So introducing Hampi, first of all, why I had selected Hampi as my thesis topic. So I have been visiting Hampi for last many years, and over the years I have made certain key observations that the tourists which are there, they visit only the specific number of structures which are under UNESCO. So the tourist pattern which is there, it is very, very specific. So the so other parts of the history which are there, which are the Ramayana chapters and the intangible heritage, always get ignored. And so there are very few chances for them to survive and develop. And then the second observation which I made was to make the entire entire campus of Hampi so that the tourist can first of all understand the intangible heritage, which is the whole and sole reason for the architecture which we see in Hampi, and then to promote the same arts and crafts under the mainstream tourism, so that they can also get a platform under which they can perform and show their skills. So in introducing Hampi is located in Karnataka on the banks of river Tungabhadra. Hampi is known as the city of victory, and it is mainly known for the Vijayanagara empire, but the history of Hampi goes way back, right from Kishkinda and Ramayana era and the Pampadevi era to the Vijayanagara Empire and the Deccan War in the 15th century, and then later during the British rule, Hampi was rediscovered again after it got destroyed in the War of 15th century with the Deccan Sultans, and then in 17th century Hampi got rediscovered and it was documented for the first time, as we can see here. This is the map. This is a map of where Hampi was documented for the first time in 1799 by Captain Colin McKenzie, and then after that in 1856 Alexander Greenlaw documented Hampi. There was the first time the Hampi was photographically documented, and after that Hampi was given to ASI after independence, and since then the conservation work of the heritage structures, only this specific heritage structures which are there under UNESCO, has been done. But in all this, the intangible heritage has been completely ignored, which is also a major part in the history of Hampi. So I wanted to include all of this in my research and later to use them in my design. So I documented the entire living crafts of Hampi. So this is the map of the 20. So the governing body in Hampi is Hampi World Heritage Area Management Authority, known as Huahama. Under Huahama, there are 28 villages, and these are the 28 villages who are documented the art forms which are there, of how much they earn, and what is their current condition, and would they like to stick to the profession for the further generation, or would they like to move on from this craft? So most of them were saying that there are not enough platform for them to showcase their talent, and because of new modern techniques, people are switching to the faster means of making crafts and handicrafts. So later, after documenting these crafts, which are stone cutting, street theater, carpentry, basket making, etc. I divided all these craft form into three parts, which are building crafts for workshop, and performing arts, which I could use later in my design to give them a platform. So what is the need of an interpretation center in Hampi? So Hampi, being a UNESCO World Heritage Site, there is no proper museum for people to visit. A small museum has been provided by ASI, which also acts as the ASI office and as well as the museum. But this small museum is not enough for people to understand the vast history of Hampi. And then the second museum, which is Kaladham, which is located almost 40 to 50 kilometers away from Hampi. So most of the tourists do not visit this center because it is far away from Hampi. And to enter this museum, you need a lots of permission because it is in the private city, which is owned by JSW. And then in early 2000, there was an interpretation center planned by the government, which later got suspended because it was in the peripheral zone of the heritage structures. So later, I needed to select a site. So the entire 28 villages of Hampi are divided into three parts, which are core, buffer, and peripheral zones. So in the core region, there is no development allowed, and in peripheral and buffer zones, you can develop structures, but it is a regulated development. That means you need to ask the permissions of the ruling body, and then there are many restrictions, such as you cannot construct above 88 meters, and there are specific materials restrictions. So this town known as Kamalapur was already growing, the government allowed the development to take place in this town, and this huge portion of land was provided for developing public and semi public spaces, and near this space across the river, across the canal, there are three heritage structures which are under ASI. So technically speaking, I could not construct in this part, but this being on the other side of the canal, the government allowed this portion of land to be under public use. So considering the context of the site and surrounding, and it is surrounded by these heritage structures, I selected this part of land as my site, and the structure here is Pathabhinama temple, and this is the original fort wall which was there, and this is another temple near the site. So the context was perfect for me to construct an interpretation center, which would help the tourists and the visitors to get more information about the structures, and so that they can already experience the temples and architecture which is there in Hampi. So this area is my site, and these are the temples here, and this is the water body which goes along the site. After locating my site, I had to study the landscape. I had to do the landscape study so that I can understand the various parameters, like such as the settlements and the university where main population or the main tourist population is there, and the settlements of the people which is nearby the site, and then the monument area which is nearby my site. And so that it is easily accessible for tourists to go and visit these structures by using cycles or by going or by walking. And then after that, to use other local materials such as bamboo, and naturally available resources. I need to locate the farms and everything which could help me to get these materials on site. So I had to document the fallow land and the cultivated land near my site, and then the running water bodies which are there throughout the 28 towns. And then the main materials, the main material which I was going to use was the locally available granite stone. So I needed to document the quarries which would allow me to get the materials from their mines and use it on my site. So these things in orange are the functioning quarries in the area under Huahama. So this is how the entire plan after putting all the layers look like. And then after that, after doing the broad documentation, I needed to cut it down to the area specific to my site. So first of all, I did the documented the religious spaces and monuments under ASI, and then the cultivated land and the green patches and the open spaces which are there, and then the commercial and residential zones which are near my site, and then the natural features, the road networks, and as well as the public buildings which are near my site. So the conclusions which I got from the entire study was first of all, my site area was around 13 acres, and the height that I was allowed to go was maximum 8 meters or G+1. And then the quarries was available. The quarries were near my site, so I could use stone as my main construction material. And then the other arts and crafts craft form which were documented earlier, I could use them and developing the in you use them in construction, and so that they can also get some sort of employment from it. So the first notion of the design for me was to depict the entire timeline of Hampi, which are the important events, like first to depict the Kishkinda era, then the Vijayanagara era, and then the ruined state of Hampi. So the tourists would get to experience the entire entire history of Hampi, entire timeline of Hampi in one go. So coming to the design response, these are the main events which are there in the history of Hampi, which is the Ramayana era, then the Vijayanagara era, the Deccan War, and then the Hampi in ruin state. So following the timeline, first of all, there was a transition space through which tourists can come in, and then this would act as a transition space into the intangible heritage, which would include workshops and performing center, which would help the tourists to understand the arts and crafts form on which the entire architecture of Hampi was built. And then the Kishkinda era, the Vijayanagara era, and then the Hampi in ruined state. So there were coconut plantations on my site. So I had to build through them, as I could not cut them. And then the blocks were placed accordingly. So the brief which was formed was first the entrance plaza, and then the admin block, then performing center and workshop block, and then a library, reading area, and viewing deck from which tourists can see all the temples which are near, and then the three interpretation centers, and then cottages for tourists to stay in the context of Hampi. So this is my plan, and then the first is the entrance plaza, through which the tourists and visitors will enter, and then there is a waiting area here, waiting area and cafe, and this is the only entry and exit to the site. So tourists come in through this entry, and then here is the admin block and the performance center, and this is the workshop block. So after you cross this, there is a live restaurant here, and then these are the viewing decks, small viewing decks which are placed throughout the edge of the site, and then there are three interpretation centers which depict the eras of the respective history, and then the cottages at the end, and there is a live library here so that people can read about the history of Hampi. This is the entrance plaza, the tourist center enter through here, and then they take the same exit going to the souvenir shop, in which the arts and craft art forms made by the local artists is available. This is the plaza for the cafe. This is the amphitheater which was derived from the stepwell which is there in Hampi, and these are the viewing deck overlooking the existing temple, and these are the interpretation centers, and this is the workshop block. So this is the first section through the through the entrance plaza, which souvenir shop. There are ticket counters in this entrance plaza, and then this is the amphitheater viewing deck and admin block, and the for this section is taken from here, and then after this the third section was taken to the semi open performing center and the workshop block. After that the tangible heritage of Hampi was documented by this interpretation centers, and then this is the second set of sections. This is the Kishkinda interpretation center. This is the Hampi Ruins Interpretation Center and Vijayanagara Interpretation Center, and at the end there are the cottages. So coming to the Interpretation Center, this is the first one. So to depict the history of Kishkinda, I had selected a temple which kind of summarized the type of architecture which was practiced during that time. So anyone who was going to these temples made during this era had a pre-hand experience of the kind of space which they were going to experience, and the visitor will enter from here, and then there is the entire exhibition space in this space there was only history depicted by the Kishkinda Empire, and then the Ramayana connection, the Jatayu chapter which happened here, and then the 3D visuals which they could experience here. So this is a circulation and vegetation. This is the open corridor spaces in which tourists can see the exhibits which are there on the railings of the structure, and these are the internal exhibition spaces, and this is the pergola layout and the roofing layout. The second one is Vijayanagara Interpretation Center. So for this I took the temple which is right across the river, the Patavinama temple which summarized the Vijayanagara architecture which used to be built. So in this temple, first of all there is a semi-open space here, and then the close spaces. So I tried to depict similar sort of spaces, similar quality of spaces, but by using this quality of spaces I tried to put in the my exhibitions here, and then the similar exhibitions in this the entire 3D visuals of the exhibitions anyone can see, and then here are the sculptures and everything. So again, this is the open corridor spaces, and then the exhibition area, the pergola layout and the roofing layout. So for the first two structures, I had a reference of the existing architecture, but to depict the ruined state of Hampi, I had picked the King's Palace, which is at the royal center. It is said that the entire palace of the king was demolished after the Deccan War, and on the Deccans left only the plinth of the structure. So it kind of symbolized the defeat of Vijayanagara Empire. So taking this profile, I place my exhibits in this spaces, so that they can experience the events or the history which happened during this era. And this is the open corridor spaces through which a tourist can move. And these are the closed exhibition spaces. And then coming to the start to my entrance plaza, the main motive to give one entry was so that tourists can come to the same exit, and they need to go through the souvenir shop, and they see the art and crafts which are available here. And then the main intention of providing this open deck was for the visual to get a pre-hand experience of what they are going to experience in the site. Like, they can easily see the amphitheater and amphitheater and the workshop block and the performing center from here. So this is the corridor space. These are the exhibition. This is the souvenir shop. This is the cafe, and this is the open sit down. This is the pergola layout and the roofing layout. So the workshop block. The main intention. Mostly the art and crafts form which are practiced here need an open space. Other than weaving and everything, rest of the art form need open space, such as stone cutting and stone carving and stuff. So I had given a central open space in which people can practice the art form and teach the art form, and then surrounding it were the closed workshop spaces in which the spaces which required the closed enclosed spaces, those art forms can be practiced. And then the restaurant space and the library space and the cottages at the end. This is the open corridor space in which anyone who has decided to stay in the cottages can can sit. And this is the pergola layout at the top to get the sun and shade effect. And then after this, I would like to show the walkthrough video, which so that you can actually feel the kind of space which was built.
Kunal, is there any audio also being played? Because we are unable to hear it.
Okay. Abhi audio aa raha?
I am not able to hear. Kiran, are you able to hear, or is there any some problem at my end?
No, I cannot hear. I'll just coordinate with Kunal and fix it.
It's okay, you can play it and just say a few words to it if while it is playing.
Okay.
To explain the video, if you could just say, that's it.
This is the entrance plaza, and this is the entire cycling deck which was provided for the tourists. And this, we are inside the entrance plaza. This is the deck which was provided outside, and this is the viewing deck overlooking the temple. This is the admin block.
A whole lot of them have been broken to build structures and temples, but still the live rocks are just sitting all over the place, create such a magical atmosphere today. This place has a historicity which goes back into 4,000 years BC. There are caves where even today there are images and carvings in the caves which are all 4,000 years old. And Agastya Muni himself seems to have come, we can say, in many ways, because he stepped in here and did something significant here. From then on, there's been no looking for this place. There's been rise and fall, but it rose to its height, true heights, during 13th, 14th century, during the great Krishnadevaraya era, when it was called as the Vijayanagara Empire.
Thank you very much, Kunal, for the wonderful presentation. We would now like to take up the questions. I think students will start typing that out on chat box, hopefully. I will start my questions. Anushka, are you there?
Yeah, I'm there.
So this one is for you. Would you like to throw some light on how this topic or the research area faced initially any field level challenges as it started quite at macro level and went down further to the micro one, right?
Yeah. So when I started with this research, honestly, it started as an encounter with the city itself. So I've been living in Thane for the past 20 years now. And so the whole area of Jamli Nakas is the daily experience that I would experience while coming to college or while going everywhere. So the whole idea started with the encounter with the city. So by that time, I really didn't know what it was going to translate into or what the imagination of the research was going to be like. So that was one of the biggest challenge that I had. And in terms of the research also, like in the beginning of the research, I was asking questions, perhaps the answers of to which I knew that were not architectural or would not translate into an architectural manifestation. So that constant thought was there, and because the kind of structure that MU also follows. And so, yeah, I would say that was the biggest concerns or the challenges that I had personally.
Great. Thanks, Anushka. A question to you, Kunal. Did you face any challenges in reflecting the historic architecture in contemporary context? As many a times, students or even for that matter, architects end up copying the things as it is and under the name of inspiration.
And this was the fear that I had initially, that I didn't want to copy the entire architecture which was there. I just wanted to get the essence of the space, like the scale and the kind of light that the temples had. And by using that, I wanted to kind of reflect the kind of architecture that was there during those respective eras. So by taking only inspire from the quality of space that was there, I tried to depict this same thing, which was later then represented in my design.
Right. This one is for both of you. Anyone can answer, or rather you two, both of you can answer. Did you ever think of the execution part of this thesis, and when was it, and how you are going about it now?
I'm actually right after the jury last year. I had gone to Hampi to present my thesis to the governing body there, and then they had taken up my proposal and discussed it within them. But after that, the proposal is still stuck. I am working with the architect which is there. So we are still working on the proposal and kind of pushing it forward with them. So there is also a competition which was soon going to be open, but now it's stuck because of the entire COVID thing. So still we don't have any updates on it, but soon we will get.
But you do have hopes on that, yeah. Anushka, would you like to answer this?
Yeah, so I would like to read something out in response to that. So, Robin Evans in his essay, Translation from Building to Drawing, says that architects do not make buildings. They make drawings of buildings. If we were to continue that argument further, it would translate as architects do not make buildings, but they shape imaginations of building and build environments. And I think my thesis itself was a provocation. It was in terms of an imagination that I have or a relationship that I have with the city. So yeah, various parts of the city can translate into the partial manifestation, but it's more like an imagination, a poetic imagination of what, even Jane Jacobs defines cities, you know, like the in her book of the Death of Great American Cities, it's the way she defines cities. So I feel like my thesis was predominantly how cities actually function. So it's already there. It's just that you need to make some twitches in here and there. But yeah, so that's what I mean. Like, I wouldn't like want the city to be built, because I don't know if this is what actually on site will actually, it's my imagination. It can differ from person to person. So I haven't thought in detail about actual manifestation.
Right. Thank you. I would just like to mention once again, both the theses were sent from our college side to NIASA competition. And after that, also these two have presented very widely at different and varied platforms. And of course, are seeking the public responses too for its enrichment and for betterment of it. We can now again look at the chat box. Kiran, are there any questions from audience side or the faculty who would like to raise any questions or add to the session are all invited.
Yeah, faculty, please go ahead and unmute yourself or even switch on your camera and ask questions. Let this more be a discussion.
There are two participants who are raising hands. Kiran, did you see them?
Yes, ma'am. Yeah. I would ask them to just unmute themselves and ask.
Yes, that will do.
Thank you. Hello, Tejashree ma'am.
Yes.
There is a question from Reshma ma'am on the chat box. You can view it and ask the participants.
Okay. I'm not able to view any question. The last chat was welcome everyone. Please put up your questions by you.
Yes, ma'am. I'll just post it. You can see it.
Reshma, ma'am, you can unmute yourself and you can also ask question on your own. Or Kiran, if you can just read that out.
Yes, ma'am, I do that. So the question is to both of the presenters. It is basically, at what prospect do you see your thesis now? Like after a year into your thesis, do you rethink about it again? And do you look at it in a different way? So this is to both of the panel members.
Yeah. Anushka, please go ahead.
Yeah. So in terms of now, when I look back to the thesis, yeah, definitely. Because like I said, the site was located in Thane. And I travel literally every day to that space. And there have been times when I've thought, you know, what if like that thing that I designed here was actually implemented? Or, you know, what if? And more than that, I think because I keep visiting, it's not a site for me, it's like just a space which I keep encountering every day and day. I have further looked at various nuances, like just to give you an example, like the whole street, the vegetable street, which works as a vegetable street in the morning, and then is getting transformed into, you know, different activities throughout the day. What happened while I went to purchase vegetables from that market was I started to look at the small nuances in which how the vendors are actually, you know, building that temporal space. Like the flower vendor who had his stall there had a small, you know, a pipe driplet that was constantly, you know, falling on the water itself. So, you know, like I would see that, like that whole question of, do we actually need to design cities? That whole question of how can we design cities? Do we really need to design cities? That question sort of lingered into my mind again and again and again. So I think one thing that I have looked back after doing my thesis is that looking at the nuances and asking greater questions and asking questions, like it has led me to ask more questions, which I could not earlier because of the restriction in terms of the time that we had, or, you know, that like it was also a lot of speculation driven, some analysis was done on the basis of my speculation, on the basis of my experience, which I find is not does not sort of work like that. So there are more learnings, definitely. Yeah, in my case.
So ma'am, whenever I go back to Hampi, I definitely visit the site and just try to imagine of what it would feel like if it would have been actually got constructed. And then looking back at the entire thesis journey, so this was the first time in our academic year that we got to choose our own topic, our own space to work, of where we want to work and how we want to design. So this was the first time that we actually got the freedom to design on our own, which is the same thing that we are doing now after graduating. So that initially widened our scope of thinking and designing of about the spaces and everything. So that helped me in gaining more insight of what can you do on your own without much restrictions on your thinking and skills.
Great, thanks both of you. There is a question by Raju Raj to Kunal. How Kunal started about the topic and research question, as it is very important for dissertation, and how he managed on coming up with the research question?
Ma'am, actually, I have been going to Hampi for each and every year because it is my native place. And after coming to architecture, I have been looking at the spaces and the problems which are there differently. Before coming to architecture, they were like the only general problems to me. But after coming to architecture, I looked at it from a point of from an eye of an architect, like how can we tackle this? So there were already observation which I was making for the 4 years before taking up this as my topic. And then after when I took it as my topic, first I approached the local architects and asked them about how are they practicing and how are they trying to make Hampi as a destination for the tourists all around the world. And then I asked the people of what do they really want, like do they want more tourists or do they want more space in sort of like there are many restrictions imposed from ASI and Huama because there is a heritage site near. And because of this, the entire villages are being taken out because they are under restricted zones. So I asked them what can we do in sort of to build a proper space to give you a platform. And then I approached the local artists and the craftsmen of what is your current situation now and how are you working and would you like your children to continue the same profession or would you like them to switch to a different one? And most of them were saying there is no platform for us to showcase our craft. And so that is how I perform my questions to a questionnaire for the locals and the craftsmen and the architects.
Right. There is another one, Sanket.
Yeah. Hi, Kunal. This is Raju Raj. Yeah. As you mentioned, Hampi is your hometown. So like I'm from Nepal and Nepal is my hometown. So I'm planning to do related to arts and craft center in Kathmandu because Kathmandu is totally a tourist based place and like rich in arts and craft. So I was thinking to work on arts and craft of Nepal as on my thesis topic. So like as you already said, because like as we know that for thesis dissertations questions research question is very important. So like how you can manage what type of questions you put on it, so like that was my question. Okay, like how you can manage
it would vary from the kind of people that you're approaching to ask question. Like if you're asking the local artisans, then you need to ask them about their crafts, which are they practicing, and are they earning enough so that they can sustain their family by practicing the same craft. And then you need to ask them what is the government doing for them to promote their art, do they want to practice the similar craft? Because of the modern interventions, people are switching to the faster modes of craft, which are readily available to people. So you need to ask them: do they want to continue, and why they want to stick to the same craft form? Like the questions will vary from the kind of people that you are asking. So you need to sort of form a personal questionnaire which they could relate to and answer in not sugar-coated way. Like they can then only you can get pure answers from them and what are they feeling now.
But as we know that this COVID situation, so I can't go 4 to 6 months there. So like how I can manage from here only, can you suggest me something?
Then you need to see the documentaries or any interviews which are available online, or what work have the government done to document this art and craft form. And then if it is not possible for you to visit the place, and then you can visit the similar spaces in which the artists are performing in in India, which are nearby you. And then you need to make assumptions on your own because you are not able to visit the site right now.
Okay. Thank you so much, Kunal.
Thank you.
There is another one by Sanket saying Ajanta and Ellora Interpretation Center is closed now. So in that scenario, what do you think the future for Interpretation Center is, or just a museum will work?
Ma'am, the Ajanta Ellora Interpretation Center was pretty huge compared to the one which I had designed, and the and it was sort of made and the I have not seen much of the Ajanta Ellora Interpretation Center, but the center was not able to connect to the local people, and it was sort of a museum only, and there were no performing arts or crafts which have been depicted. There were only the things which they had taken from the caves, and they had displayed in like we have in museum. Like there was no interaction between the people and the exhibits which were there. So if the kind of interpretation center that we are going to construct are this, then museums will work. But if we want to create interpretation center, then they need to be interactive with the users, with the local people and the this exhibit itself.
There is one by Jinu sir. Looking back in time, what would you do differently in terms of research and the design? Also looking forward, your thoughts on how students should approach their dissertation. This can be answered by both Anushka and Kunal.
Okay, so ma'am, firstly, what would I have done differently? Like the time that we have in the second half of the design in the semester pattern is very less compared to the time that we have for the research. Like we hardly have 4 to 5 months in hand to complete our design. So the kind of approaches that we take towards the design are very limited. Like we mostly try one or two approaches to design, and then try to work the design itself from that limited sort of approach. So if we so if I wanted to try more different approaches to the design, but considering the time restrictions, I was not able to.
Anushka, any response from your side?
Yeah, like this point which Kunal mentioned is completely true, at least in my case. By somewhere in until Jan, I was figuring out how would my research translate into I had to convince peers, faculties to let me go ahead with what I was doing, and somewhere in that process and that pressure, I feel the kind of intervention that came in with a sense of bias. It did not come out on, like I said, it came out from my own experience. So it was my own bias that resulted into the reflection of what the intervention was. And that was due to, pretty much because of the limitation that we had in terms of time, but not using that as an excuse. What I would also, I mean, done something differently, of course, would have, it would have meant giving more time to what I was trying to do, try it out really on, as a pilot on site, ask people if that works, and maybe interact with the municipal authority to sort of, understand their idea on this. It would have been more realistic. And in terms of what we look forward, like how the current students can approach the dissertation, it's a very uncertain time because like there is complete lack of field. The field is completely absent. There is no, I mean, people cannot personally go on field the previous question that Kunal also addressed. That how can we know about something that where we don't go, how do we interact with people? So I feel that is one of the limitations which
these current students will face. That being said, I feel that it can also be treated as an opportunity because they have larger questions to ask, right? I mean, if we look at the whole, if we look at the non-essential services, artists, architects are being termed as, you know, like, yeah, non-essential service providers. And we're clearly lagging on our part to sort of provide our, the whole 5 years, we've sort of understood that as architects, we have some social responsibility, we have some social responsibility towards the community, but that's clearly lacking at the professional level. So I think these theses can be targeted towards asking these bigger questions. Like we look at the current border issue that's happening between China and India. We see that people policies are being driven as to how we imagine borders as not as hard infrastructures as a place for encounter, but as a place for friendship. So I think these current students have these questions to ask because of the current circumstances we are in, which we did not. I mean, so I think, those are some approaches wherein people can sort of engage with real scenarios because it does have a lot of implication to our role as an architect in the society.
Yes. Thanks, Anushka. There is another question for Kunal. When you started with Hampi as area of concern, other than interpretation center, did you have any other design possibilities considered at conceptual stage? Have we lost Kunal's connection? Is Kiran, can you find out? I can't see Kunal in the list.
Yeah, he's not there.
Yes, I'll check.
Okay, great. I do not see any more question in the chat box.
There is one for Anushka from Yogita Gosavi. Did you face any traffic problem while designing? Do you feel traffic is obstruction to put forward to your thoughts in design? How did you solve?
Anushka, you're on mute.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Traffic obviously was one problem when I was making the video, recording the video. However, I had help of friends and family. But apart from I wouldn't say that was one of the biggest issues because by the end of 2 months, even the police knew that I'm here to sort of document stuff. And anyone would ask me, and the police would come and be like, "Arey, pata nahi hai kya ye madam aati hai? Inko document kare do, kuch nahi karegi, sirf dekh ke jayegi." So there were people who were like, why is she here? What is she doing? Why is she recording us? She's going to kick us out of here because they were informal. They're always in that, they don't want to interact with you because they feel, you'll kick them out of there. So they're always, so that aspect of trust was, I think, one of the biggest problems. Like I had to establish that trust. Like I'm here, I'm not going to do anything. This is just a study, which is for an academic purpose. And also, when you're going on site and interacting with people who don't know you and people who are, working, are there on site, they start observing that you come daily. So in some sense, I was also scared because there were 2-3 times wherein men would sort of come up and start, checking my notes rigorously. And I mean, there was one incident where he took my pencil and threw away. So you have to be very cautious while you're doing such field studies because they are scared and it's not their fault. It's our fault because we as an outsider always want to we might come out as an intruder. So I think that was a greater challenge as compared to traffic. Like traffic, you can toss it. You can that's what I did. I just tossed it and I had family and I had people with me who were holding my stuff and I would record or they would record for me. So that was not itna bada issue for me.
So we apologize on the technical glitch that we have from Kunal's side and he's trying and joining in. But till then, yes, thank you, Anushka. There's one more question at my end. Hope you don't mind me asking. So how were your experiences while presenting at different platforms?
It's always nice, and you realize after every presentation where you messed up, what you said would, I mean, like, it's always mixed, and I feel nervous also before presenting it, and I mean, it's mixed emotions. It's like you're constantly thinking, how might people think about your research, how might people take it, and there's also this bigger question as that it should not translate as this one process which can be sort of retrofitted to suit your own I don't know how people might reciprocate, and I mean how people might take it. So there's this constant thought or process behind their back, like it's always been like, was my dissertation too much of a thesis, or was it overdone? So these are the questions which keep occurring into my mind, and after every presentation I realize, okay, yeah, like this was somewhere I lagged, this was somewhere, you know, I could have done better. So after every presentation, I think I self-reflect, and that's the only thing I feel.
Thank you, Anushka. I do not see any more questions. I hand over to Kavita Pradhan, ma'am.
Ma'am, Kunal is back, so he can answer the question.
Great. So Kunal, there is a question for you. When you started with Hampi as area of concern, what were different intervention possibilities other than interpretation center considered at conceptual stage?
Ma'am, first of all, when I started to do more research about this topic, the thing that I realized that the history of Hampi was not being properly documented. So the first thing that I had in mind was to build a space where history can be documented, like, and can be preserved and can be displayed to the people and the tourists who are coming there. So then I tried to look at the things through which I can display the history. So the first thing which came to my mind was museum, and there is already an existing small museum in Hampi, which I wanted to do. And then the second thing was the interpretation center, which is more of an interactive museum, like you can interact with the display and everything which is there. And so I decided to, after considering museum, I decided to build the design the interpretation center, and then the rest of the design followed.
Yes, thanks, Kunal. One more question to Anushka. How was the jury's response and comments on your thesis, especially when it caters to an urban scale?
That's a very emotional, a very personal question. So I think in both of my juries, I was about to flunk, like even in my research jury and even in my final dissertation jury, I think they were not at least in my research dissertation jury, I couldn't even explain anything. I couldn't even say anything. This whole, there wasn't any jury only. Like it was, the jury was rather with my guide asking her, how can she take a topic like that? So that jury didn't actually happen. So after which I went to Kivya, and I went to some professors. I met some professors out there, and I spoke to them, and I got their inputs, because I felt it was important for me to gain those inputs to go ahead, because I practically did not have any jury. It was a discussion on just the topic itself. And after which my dissertation jury, I understood that at the back of the mind, I knew that there was going to be an architecture, but every thesis topic is going to be it's not going to be just architecture, right? It's going to be interior designing or architecture. It's going to be some but it depends on how you define architecture. So for me, it was
to sort of look at the whole precinct as one thing in terms of architecture, but I understood that it can be problematic at a final year thesis level. So I was constantly trying to scale it down to architecture and then also parallelly do what I wanted to do. So in my final year, my final thesis presentation, luckily I had an urban designer who took my jury, and there were two people who generally take the jury. So one response was extremely good and the other response was, there was no response. So I think that way it worked out for me pretty well at the end. So, yeah.
Okay, great. There is one common question to both of you. What would be your advice to the current thesis students regarding the time management for research and designing, as it is quite crucial with regards to a student performance and the design outputs?
When you are having your internship semester, it is important after that semester is over that you start thinking about the topic that you want to select right after the internship semester that is there, and not after your college is started. Like, you need to have something pre-hand that you can discuss with the faculties or your guides, that what do you want to design or how do you want to go about your thesis. Like the area that, like any issue that you want to tackle, or any area or any site specific project. And then in many of the cases, students are not able to finalize their design topics till the month of July end or something. And then they take up any random topic, which is easy for them to tackle. So I would advise to not do something like that and to stick to your process. And you will find something through which you can work out the design and the research part. And it is important for you to show the to implement the research part, and that the research should contribute to your design, and both the research part and the design should not be like completely different. Like, your research part should be the base of your designing.
Anushka, would you like to add?
Yeah, it's not only thesis wherein we sort of that block exists that only in when we're doing a thesis we have to do the research and then we have to build something. But I think that's the process we follow even during, like, right from the first year. Like, we don't just directly take up a brief and we start designing. Like, we look at the site, we look at the site response, and then the faculty also come up with a brief and then we start designing. So I feel that it's just that when you're doing your thesis, it comes with a scale, it comes down, and then, it's just that you're doing it by yourself now, and there is no one else to decide things for you. So in terms of management, like Kunal rightly said, that it has to, like, your research has to obviously reflect in your response. So you need to sort of remember that even when you're doing your research, at the back of your mind, you need to understand that this research ka ek purpose hai. Like, just like question at the back of your mind, it shouldn't be absolute. Here, I'm not saying that ki you do the research keeping in mind ki I have to design this. No, I'm not saying that. I'm just saying that whatever you're doing, like, if suppose I am studying a particular site and I'm looking at the site, so I ask questions according to the built form of it or the spatial manifestation of it that can result into some built form, or that can result. So, but that doesn't mean you purposely sort of impose your ideologies on it. But so it has to go in hand, and I think that's the perfect way to sort of manage your time equally for your research and also for your design, so that it's not even in isolation. It's already from the beginning, it's together.
We'll just take one last question. This one is for Kunal. Was there any interaction made with the architects, as there are architects like Chetan Shivprasad already working for Hampi and the areas around? and if they were interacted with, then how they helped you in the research process?
Yes, ma'am. I had met Chetan Shiva Prasad back in June, July, when I started to work on this topic. And then after that, I had worked with him in a couple of workshops. He has a workshop center known as Hampi Center for Design. And then there is another architect, Sarat Jayachandra, who practices in Bangalore and who has quite a good hand on the architecture which is practiced in Hampi. So I had interacted with both of them. They had helped me with the rules and regulations which are there in the heritage site. And after that, how can you try to depict the entire sort of history into a contemporary way, and what sort of materials and everything that you should need to consider? So these are the two architects which helped me with everything, with my research part, then the documents which I had needed, and then later in my design.
Great, thank you both of you. And I now would like to hand over to Kavita Pradhan, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you, Tejashree, for conducting this session. And this was absolutely a wonderful beginning for our PIA thesis forum. Thank you all for joining here, and I'm sure you will come again, as this is a continuous series. So I would like to thank Sudhna ma'am for supporting this initiative, and obviously Anushka and Kunal for your insightful presentations in this first session. I really appreciate support from all my colleagues, especially Tejashree, and thanks Neha for helping out in figuring all the technicalities of hosting this event. And also I would like to thank Kiran Patel from Students Council, who he has tirelessly worked on this in connecting us with all the ex-PIKENs and getting them to come here on this platform to the current students and also the faculty. And so I look forward to your continuous support here, and we will have more such sessions. So let's meet again next Thursday at 5 p.m. Okay. And I hope all of you will come here again, because this is a discussion forum so that we all can talk about design dissertations and help each other learn from each other and make PIKA more and more matured when it comes to design dissertations. So thanks all. See you next Thursday.
One second, can I just read Christo's question, and I think I wrongly addressed it. Can I just re-answer that once? If Christo, yeah. So Christo's question was, how will the market in the center of the road won't increase the traffic? So Christo, the market was the market was not in the center of the road. The market originally existed there. And the thesis just reimagined the market, the existing market itself. So I hope that answers your question.
Okay. So I think that's it. We're done here. See you all next Thursday.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. कभी इनसे बात